Last week, if you were here, we went up on the mountain with Jesus in Mark chapter 9, where Jesus transfigured, revealed himself in his deity to the three inner circle. We talked about a lot of things last week that God reveals about us and about him in those mountaintop experiences, and how we need those for confirmation, for encouragement, and we long for those times when God shows up in our life and just fills us and surrounds us, and everything else disappears except the presence of God. I long for those days, those times. But that's not where we live. Beginning with verse 14 of Mark chapter 9, it says, "And when they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and scribes arguing with them." So if you would, pause for just a moment and think about the connection between last week and this week as Jesus and Peter, James, and John are on the mountain and God reveals himself and Moses and Elijah show up and they are so filled with the presence of God and seeing the deity of Jesus Christ. They've been on that mountaintop, and think about how pumped they are and how excited and just overwhelmed and filled. And then it says they came down off of the mountain to where the other nine disciples were, and when they got there, they saw a big crowd in an argument. And immediately, all the crowd, when they saw him, were greatly amazed and ran up to him and greeted him. And he asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" Someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they were not able." And he answered them, "O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And it has often cast him into the fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help." And Jesus said to him, "If you can, all things are possible for one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe, help my unbelief." Does that ring in your heart? I believe, Lord, help my unbelief. And when Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. When he entered the house, the disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" And he said to them, "This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer." Some translations, King James included, include the phrase prayer and fasting. It depends on the manuscripts. This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. It's interesting that the people were amazed when they saw Jesus. It's amazing that people would run and flock to him, and the disciples, seeing all that's going on, looking at the crowd in argument with the scribes and arguing because there's a lot of things at play. This guy brings his son that is demon-possessed. the disciples who Jesus had given power earlier to cast out demons when he sent them out were unable to do anything about that. So it was frustrating for them as well as it was for the crowd. And they come to this place. They came down from the mountain and walked into the valley. And man, the valley was there. As we often come down into the valley where we live, there are some things this morning I want us to think about that we see in this passage. Mountaintop spiritual experiences where God shows up and fills your spirit. And I liken it to say there's been times that the Lord's been so real, I believe I heard angels sing. And there's just this movement in my spirit, and I know the presence of God is there. And it's awesome, but the truth is there does come a time when we have to get back to life. And we come back into the valley because this is where we live the day-to-day. And the challenge that we have as we come down is to explain to the people in the valley what we experienced on the mountain. In other words, what we find where we live, guys, this is the truth about living in the valley. It is full of people with needs. People that hurt. People like us. Everyone sitting here this morning has some need, some hurt, something in their life that causes them, even if it's just for a brief moment, to wince and grit their teeth when they hear something or they see something or an experience takes place. We all live in a place of pain because that's where we live in the valley. Life is like that. Our job as the people of Christ that have had the opportunity to be in the presence of God, to feel Him, our job and the challenge is to translate that to the hurting people around us. It's interesting that after we've had that mountaintop experience, it seems as though the bottom falls out, doesn't it? And we think we're doing good. We're growing in the Lord. We're studying the Scriptures, and the Lord is opening our mind and our understanding. And then life, some silly little something or some major big something steps in. But I want to explain something. What we experience in the private, intimate time with God when He reveals Himself to us and we are supercharged with the presence of the Holy Spirit and we see God for who He is, those things are meaningless if it doesn't translate into life. There's no purpose in meeting with God on the mountain and having this awesome experience if it does not translate into life, if it doesn't affect life, if it doesn't help us have compassion, help us understand the mission of why we're here. What is the value of a church having revival if it does not go out and reach the lost? What good is revival among the body if we leave the world in a dead condition? What's the value of God filling me, revealing Himself to me, if I don't use that and translate that to those around me that are hurting? God gives us those experiences to equip us to minister, to equip us to help, to give hope. God gives us those experiences because we need the power of God. I wrote this down because this explains my ministry so often. We find ourselves working and working to do His work and His will without much success. Seems like everything we do, the harder we work, the less success we have. So what do? We roll up our sleeves and we work even harder. We just keep digging in and we keep going, only to fail again. And most of the time we don't understand why. I'm trying, I'm doing, I'm studying, I'm doing everything I know to do. Why does it seem that my personal ministry, the ministry of our church, whatever, why does it seem like we take 2 steps forward and 10 steps backwards? And it's frustrating. And I look at this and I remember those mountaintop experiences when God showed himself. And I think, well, maybe we're not working hard enough. Maybe I should try something different. What is it that I've missed? What's going on? When the reality is, it's life. Ministry takes place in life. And the crowd was arguing. And the religious leaders were arguing. And the disciples were trying to defend themselves. Guys, I don't have the answer as to why life always seems to try to pull us down after we've been up. I don't know why it seems like when we try to draw closer to the Lord and get involved in His work, well, I do know that the attacks become even greater. Why the disappointments are most severe. Why the discouragement becomes debilitating. It's because we're in a valley. I bet if I would get alone with every one of you and we'd just sit over coffee and talk, and I'd say, is there times that you just feel like the more you push towards God, the further He seems to get away? The harder you work, the less result you see. Are there times in your life when you long for that and you begin going backwards in your mind and trying to relive the glory days of when you got saved and the Holy Spirit filled you up, or when you had a tremendous spiritual victory, and you go back and you start wanting to hold on to those things because all that you're dealing with right now is emptiness and frustration? How many of y'all have had a period where God just didn't speak to you other than in His Word? You know? And I know He doesn't have to, because He's given us His Word. But we all like that personal moment when we feel God just speak in our heart. And you've gone through times when He's silent. In the valley, not only do we encounter crowds of hurting people, often we become one of the hurting people. And we need the mountaintop to sustain us in the valley. This man's problem with his son was caused by a demon that had taken possession of his son. We look at that and we go, oh, that's so old. You know, is that possible? Yes, it's possible. And you'll have to remember there are many verses that tell us. One, we don't fight flesh and blood, but a spirit, the power. And our weapons of this warfare are mighty through God. You can't fight the power of darkness and despair that Satan has unleashed in the world with human tools and understanding. It is a spiritual warfare. The disciples that were there, the 9, were incapable of casting this demon out. Sometimes it seems as though we're incapable of answering the question, of finding the solution. But that's where we live, in the valley. Secondly, this is where we find out the truth about what we have to offer in the valley. Think this through for a moment. Whether we understand it or not, this church building that sits here with the name on the front that now, thankfully, you can read at 75 miles an hour. And I just want to say something about that, if I might. For a long time, we were in an identity crisis with Palladura Cowboy Church. Everybody say, oh, you're out there on the Hereford Highway. No, we're on the other side of town. Oh, okay. And we went through that phase. And then we built our building and stuff. And I said, you know, we're the one out on Hunsley Road before you get to Washington. Oh, that's what that is. I've wondered what that building was. Well, it's a church. Well, if you don't drive by on Sunday morning, you wouldn't know what this building was. Right? So now they know. Can't say that. 42 foot of letters up there that tell you what we are. I love it. Now I can say, you know the church? Oh, the one with, yeah, I know where that is. Yeah, I've seen that. But do you all understand that whether we understand it or not, this building sets out here on the road, and just this building being here makes a promise to a hurting world. Just it being here. It gives a promise to a hurting world that this is a place where God meets with His people. And they may not consider themselves to be one of God's people, but they know this building on this road, on Hunsley Road, is a promise to a hurting world that there is a place where God meets with His people. It's a promise that if you need God, you can find Him here. If you need help, you can find it here. If you need answers, you can find them here. It's a promise that we make just by being here. We often don't think about that, do we? I know that the church is not the building. The church is the body of Christ that meets. We are the church that meet in this building. But yet us establishing a house of God, a house of worship for all the public to come to, leaves a promise to a hurting world that if I need God, I can go there and find hope and help and answers. When people come to Canyon Country Church and they worship with us, what is it that they leave with? What is their thought? Do they see the power of God at work in our lives? Do they see people who are being changed by the power of God? Do they come seeking fellowship, acceptance, but leave saying they could not? Think about it. This man came to bring his child to Jesus. Jesus wasn't there. Who were his representatives? The disciples. He had a real felt need, a real life need. His son was possessed by a demon that would throw him down and cause him to foam at the mouth, and he would go into convulsions, try to kill him, throw him into the fire, throw him into the water. This man is living a life of misery. He can't leave his son unattended because he never knows when the demon will attack him and throw him down. And his whole family in town is known as the guy, oh yeah, that's the family with the demon-possessed son. The stigma that's upon him. The fear for his son's life. The fear for his wife probably and his other children. Not knowing what. Just think of the life this man has lived since this boy was young. And we don't know how old he is, but it seems like it's been a long time. And what he says, he's lived this life of torment. And he comes, if you will allow me, to the church for help. And they could not. That should stick somewhere in us, that people come here for help. Do they find it among us as they see the power of God moving among us, as they see the testimony of transformed lives among us? Or do they walk away going, they could not. That one's been sticking with me all week, guys. That one's been keeping me awake at night. About my own life, and about our life as a church. You see, when we're in the valley and we're among hurting people, we find out whether we have anything to offer really or not. Friendship goes for a ways. Good programs carry for a little bit. Awesome children's program will hold them for a moment. Coffee and donuts, well, if you're here early. But you know what holds people and helps people? Seeing the power of God moving among God's people. And we sit here and say, well, if I could meddle for a moment, I promise I won't be too meddly. No, I ain't gonna promise that. Are we here today for what we get or what we give? Are we here today to soak up or to pour out? There are times when we all need to receive. And trust me, as your pastor, there's been a lot of Sundays in my life that I've climbed in the pulpit ready to preach, and my heart was heavy and my heart was broken and my emotions were empty, and I needed to hear from God. I needed to receive. So I understand that there are times when I come. But if I only come for what I like, if I only come for what makes me happy or what makes me feel, if I only come to get, then I cannot help those with need. I cannot give them hope because I have none to offer. I can't give them assurance. We've been called to be the body of Christ that leads people in the valley to the mountaintop. What do we really have to offer a hurting world? When you peel all of the stuff down, all we have to offer a hurting world is Jesus Christ. And that's all we need. Because that's all that helps a hurting world is Jesus Christ. I fear that in many churches today, the sign on the door as the folks go out should read, and they could not. God forbid that someone that's out here among us in the valley, living with life, hurts, and fears, and questions, comes through the doors of this church and cannot find answers because the power of God is moving here. I pray that we as the body of this church, never become so content and complacent that we fail to minister the hope to a hurting world. What do we have to offer? Jesus Christ. What else do we need to offer? Jesus Christ. That's all we need. That's all we need. Jesus said, bring him. It's interesting. And he says, oh, you faithless generation, how long do I have to be with you? Wow. How long do I bear with you? Bring him here. How many of y'all know what it's like to be disappointed with somebody? You ever been disappointed in anybody? You ever been disappointed in somebody in church? You ever been disappointed by a Christian? Yeah. You see, all of us know what it's like to be disappointed with people because people are fallible. We're not perfect creatures. We are prone to stumble. Human nature is that eventually somebody will let you down. You hang out with me long enough, you spend enough time with me, I eventually will let you down some way. And you'll let me down some way because we're human. Jesus said, bring him to me. But I do wonder how many people in that world that we look at out there, how many people will go to hell, and we'll be blunt, because of some Christian that let them down, not because Christ can't save them. How many people will walk away from the only place of hope and help, not because Christ can't, but because somebody that called themselves a Christian, or somebody that is a Christian, or somebody in the church let them down? They were disappointed. That's a scary thought, isn't it? You see, the problem is, we point to ourselves, not to Christ. Too often we point to ourselves and we say, well, take a look at this guy, or take a look at that guy. And if you come to church here and you're always thinking about the people around you, and you got leadership guys here this morning, we got elders and trustees here this morning that helped me make the decisions. In fact, if I can be blunt with you, the leadership guys make 99% of the decisions about what goes on. They consult with me. I trust their leadership. That's why we have them, right? To give us leadership. I'm talking about in things in the church. I don't trust them on what to preach. But when Jesus said, bring them to me, it's a reminder that the reason we bring folks to the house of the Lord, the reason is because of Jesus Christ, not because of who we are. And if our ministry and everything that we do in our life says, look at me, look at me, look at me, then we're not going to actually help hurting people. We're just going to hurt them more. If my life is about me, then it can't be about them. So Jesus said, bring him. I heard a quote, and I'm going to give it to you. Many Christians will continue to sit on the sidelines and never accomplish anything for Christ because of the failure of some other Christian in their life. Think about that. Many Christians will sit on the sidelines and never accomplish anything in the kingdom of heaven simply because of the failure of some other Christian. How many people have give up, sat down, said, fine, I'm not going to do it, because some deacon, elder, preacher, teacher failed them? You see, it's in the valley that we find out what we have to offer. It's in the valley that we find out what's necessary to actually help hurting people, and it's not us. It's not us. It's Christ. In verses 21 and 24, I want to read that again. And Jesus asked his father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. And it has often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can, all things are possible for one who believes. And immediately the father of the child cried out and said, I believe, help my unbelief. This is kind of the meat of where I wanted to get today. This man comes to Jesus and he wants help with his problem. How many of you have ever gone to the Lord with a problem? Yes, I've got a problem, Lord. This past week, and I want to share it now with my church family, this past week, I had a biopsy on a nodule in my neck, and the doctor was concerned enough to stick me 7 times and draw out tissue to find out. with my family history of cancer, my doctor takes no unnecessary risk. I mean, if he sees something, we're all over it. And I spent a week, well, actually, it's been a month process because they found it a little over a month ago. And I've prayed to the Lord a lot about that little problem. I've carried it to him on a daily basis 4 or 5 times a day. God, you know this thing here? I need you to fix my problem. Got the report back Friday. It's benign. Everything's cool. We're just going to keep checking on it every year. And I'm cool with that. But you know what it's like to have a problem, and you take that problem and you lay it at the feet of Jesus. And it can be a financial problem, a marital problem, a child problem. It can be a health problem. It can be an emotional, depressive problem. It can be, you name it. There are problems. There's a plethora of problems that surround us in the world. And this man has a major problem. He's dealt with this for years with his son afflicted. It's tormented him. It's tormented his family. It's tormented the people around him. And he has this huge problem. And he wants help. Anything wrong with wanting help with a problem? No. But interestingly, Jesus is not concerned about his problem. He's not really about fixing the problem. He's about cultivating his faith. He wants to build faith in the man. Because he says, if you can believe, all things are possible. It's like this. Well, you have this issue. Do you believe that I can fix it? Do you believe? Yes, Lord, I believe. And then the famous verse that we've all cried out, Lord, help my unbelief. The man wants help with his problem no more. Jesus wants to cultivate his faith. See, the question that Jesus says is, it's not whether I'm able, but whether you believe I can. It's not whether God is able to fix your problem, whether it's a health problem, a marriage problem, a problem with the child, a problem financially, whatever that problem is, it's not a question, is God able? We know God is able. Do you believe that He is able? It's not a question of can God or will God? It's, is He able? And do you believe that? If you have a health issue this morning, do you believe that God is able to heal that? You've got a kid that's off in the weeds somewhere wandering around like this young man that maybe has the power of Satan upon him. Do you believe that God is able to free that child? Do you believe? Yes. If your marriage is struggling and you don't know why, do you believe that God is able to restore? Yes. But you see, we only seek solutions to our problem without understanding that we are the problem. What do you mean? You saying that I'm causing my own marital problems? Or causing my own financial problems? Well, probably financial. Yeah, could be. Bad choices. I don't know. You saying what I'm saying is that Jesus is interested in something far deeper than the immediate problem that we're staring at. Jesus is interested in transforming eternity for us and those around us as He builds our faith. Think about it. Jesus wants to cultivate His faith. We've looked at a couple of other stories before in Mark. Jesus tells us about the man that came and said his daughter was sick and Jesus waited till she died. Remember that? Hey, my daughter's sick. Okay. He tarried and he died. And then Jesus went up and raised her. Think about Lazarus when Mary and Martha come running and said, hey, our brother's sick. He said, all right, and he hung out another day. Waited till he was dead. And then he come and said, Lazarus, come forth. And then we talked just a couple weeks ago about the Syrophoenician woman. And Jesus said, yeah, you got a problem. But, you know, I came for the house of Israel, not you. You remember that? Talk about rocking your world. Come to God and He says, no, it's not for you. But what did he say? If you'll remember the message, what a great faith. What was he cultivating? He could have fixed the problem, right? Was he interested in the problem? I'm not going to speak for God. He healed the problem. He fixed the problem. But what was he trying to build in those people? Faith. What is he doing with this man? Jesus told him, the question's not whether I'm able, but whether you believe. Faith does not consist in believing that God will do something, but that God can do anything. It's not faith that consists in me believing that God is able to do X. Like, let me rephrase that. The question is not whether I'm able, but whether you believe. I wrote this down so I could get it right, and then I messed it up anyway. Faith does not consist in believing that God will do something. Let's pause there. It's not just believing that God will do. I believe that God will bless you. I believe that God can heal you. I believe God will. That's not where faith consists. That's just phrasing and speaking. You know what faith believes? It believes that God can do anything. I don't even have God. There's nothing beyond God. Nothing beyond God. Do you believe that God can heal the physically ill? Yes. Do you have faith in that? Yeah. Do you believe that God can restore lives and transform lives that are so far into the gutter? Do you believe God can restore those? Yeah. Do you believe God can raise the dead? Wait a minute now. Yes, I do. As we are wrestling with our problem, Jesus wants us to wrestle with our faith. He wants to build our faith, strengthen our faith. Why do you think that it takes some time, as I said earlier, when we are dealing and we're crying out to God and we're on our face before God bringing a problem and we're saying, God, I trust, God, I believe, God, I trust, God, I believe, and God doesn't move? Why? Because he's finding out if we really trust or we really believe, and he is building our faith a step at a time. A step at a time, a piece at a time. This man just wanted to see his son healed. There's nothing wrong with that. But if the only reason we come to Jesus is because we have a problem that we want fixed, that's the only reason that we approach the Lord, is because my marriage is broke or my kid is lost or my finances are gone or I just lost my home. If the only reason that we come to Jesus is because we have a problem that we need to be fixed, when that problem is fixed, where does that leave us? I mean, we have to be honest. How many times have you ever said, God, if you'll get me out of this jam, I'll never, ever do that again, only to do that again? How many times do we say, God, if you will just fix this, I promise, I'll never go back, but yet we always find ourselves going, how many times have we repented of sin and said, I'll never do that again, only to do it again? Because if we only come for solutions to an immediate problem, we'll never understand faith. Paul said, God, remove this thorn from my flesh. And God said, I can, but I'm not. Think about that. Now, you're just going to live in grace. Grace is sufficient. Live with the problem. Endure the problem. Carry the problem to your grave, but live in grace. Now, how many of y'all think that Paul's faith was built in part and strengthened in part because of the problem? Yeah. I fear a life of ease for Jeff. I'm scared of living a life without trouble. Sound weird? If everything is going great, if everything is going perfect and everything is going smooth and my life is awesome and and I have no challenges. I have no problems. I have nothing that I need to depend on God for. Who will I depend on? I want to remind us again of what Liddy said. I don't remember because I went with them to two services when our missionaries from France. I don't know if she said it here or if it was there. She told me this. And I want you to take note of this. This is painful, but it's true. She said, I'm so scared to raise my kids here. I want us to get home to France where it's safe. Think about that for a moment. We're saying, oh, we're blessed that you'd be willing to take them little old girls to a place like that, a place of, you heard the numbers on spiritual darkness, right? Like 0.2%. She said, I am afraid to raise my children in a society of lukewarm Christianity. Her biggest fear is not the darkness of France, it's the lukewarmness of America. That ought to just cause convulsions in our stomach. That you can be here and you can be a Christian and you can be lukewarm. You can just come and sit and then you can leave. You can listen to K-Love and do a Bible study and just, because you got a good job and you got enough money. You've got everything you need. Everything's all right. Life is good. You can just kind of attach yourself to the church and just kind of, you know, be church folk without being committed to the cause of Christ. In France, you're either in or out. There's no middle ground. You're either sold out or you're just out. Because the opposition is so strong that when you make a profession of faith and you stand in it, you have to stand 100% in it. In America, it's like taking a warm bath. You can be or not be. You can be, and you're going to find a church that suits your itch. If you don't like this one, you can go to another one that you'll find that will make you feel comfortable and make you feel homey and make you feel good. Won't challenge you to do anything too much. They're out there. They're everywhere. But you see, it's in the valley that we live that we find the truth of our faith. What is our faith built on? Is it built on the circumstances where everything's good and I just assume that God's blessed me? Or is it built on need and I understand that the only solution for that need is Jesus Christ? And I'm going to trust even if I don't see the answer to my problem. Because faith is built on what it can't see. Right? Not on what is seen. If I can see the answer to every problem, do I need faith to step forward? No. The man wants help for a problem, and Jesus wants to cultivate his faith. I love his statement, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. I think this is one of the most honest responses recorded in Scripture, don't you? God, I believe, help my unbelief. He declared his faith publicly and then recognized it was weak. Yes, I have faith, and boy, is it a weak faith. And in his weakness, he pleads for the help of the Lord. If only we would be so honest. Because it's in the valley that we discover that only Jesus can help. Jesus took this young man, cast him out. You know, Satan doesn't give up without a fight. Satan fought the last time. He threw the boy down, and I mean stretched him out, foamed at the mouth, grinding his teeth, thrashing him on the ground. Satan won't give up easy, but he has to give up because Jesus commanded. I think too often we forget that Jesus can command and all things have to respond. Only Jesus can help a hurting world. Sandra made mention of all of the things that we're doing with the technology as being tools, and that's what they are. They are tools. They are tools to get a hearing with people. The Facebook app, or the app and the Facebook and the website and all that, we've had that stuff a long time. It just was so buried and unusable that nobody knew we had it. Now it's usable. And those are just tools. It's a way that we can reach out with to find and encounter and engage with hurting people. Not everybody's going to use it. I understand that. But some will. And it gives a picture of who we are as a church and kind of how our services go and what our children's department looks like and all of that, which is awesome. But I just want to be real blunt with you guys. We don't have anything to offer at this church that can help anybody except Jesus Christ. Our women's group can't help. It's Jesus that helps. Women's group can connect, right, to Jesus. Our men's group can't help people. But we can use it as a tool to connect people to Jesus. Our worship services, you can come here and you can go away and you won't find help here from the worship service itself. You'll find help from Jesus Christ, because that's where the help lies. So as we move down into the end of the passage, I'm going to close this out. The disciples that could not asked Jesus, why could we not? Isn't that a great question? God, why can't I see the power? How many of y'all want to see the power of God just pour out? I want to see it. I'm scared. I'll be honest with you. I'm scared of what that looks like. But I'd love to just see God open the roof of this building and pour a full dose of His power out upon us, whatever that looks like. But I'm scared, a little bit nervous, a little bit fearful of that. I want to see it. I want to see people get real about their life and their faith. You remember the story of Gideon? I mean, remember the story of Gideon? Gideon was going to have to go to war against the Midianites. God told Gideon to put together an army. Gideon gathers up, I don't remember the exact numbers, I'd have to go back and look, but he gathers up thousands. And God says, okay, awesome. That's too many. Cut the herd. And he went through this series of things where people would come, people would go, and God would keep peeling the army down. And he's going to fight a huge army, and he starts with thousands, and he winds up with 300. God said, okay, there you go. That's your army. 300 against thousands? Scary, isn't it? Sometimes we feel like that's what we're doing. And understand my heart. I watch our church. It hadn't been but about a year and a half, 2 years ago that we had 200 people here. Remember that? I mean, every pew full, every Sunday. I knew we couldn't sustain that. We didn't have space. And people are funny. They won't sit in a tight space. Well, they got room now. And I've watched this. And don't you think that I haven't been before the Lord on my face in tears and begging, what's going on? What are we doing? What are we not doing? I said earlier, you begin to question everything. And you just roll up your sleeves and you work harder and you keep digging in. You try to figure out what's the solution, what's the answer. Why are our numbers going this way, not this way? And this doesn't sound very positive, but trust me, it will sound positive in the end, because it is a positive thing. Because I understood what Gideon understood. If we're going to affect the world for Jesus Christ, we're going to have to do it with people that are sold out. No reserve. No backup. That trust God and walk in faith. This may sound strange from your pastor. My heart breaks for the empty pews. These empty places keep me awake at night with the questions. What if? What happened? How come? I don't have the answers. I don't have an answer. But I do know this. God is preparing a church, and we are in the process right now that really wants to change the world. And we may be peeled down to bare bones. I don't know what that means. But Gideon went and won the victory over the Midianites with 300 men that weren't afraid. 300 men that understood, because the power of God and their faith in God gave them the victory. You know how we're going to fill this building for the power and the glory of God? It's not going to be with awesome programs. Now we'll get a hearing, but what's eventually going to make it happen is the power of Jesus Christ being poured into the lives of people. The transformation power of Jesus Christ that grabs the hearts of people. But that's why I asked the question in the beginning. When people come, what do they see? Do they see people that is being transformed, that the power of God is alive, or do they just see more folk sitting there filling a spot? When the disciples came and Jesus wasn't there, and the disciples came to the Sanhedrin and began to argue, and the man brought them to the nine guys that wasn't there. Do you know why they couldn't do anything? Do you know why they couldn't heal him? Do you know why they couldn't cast out the demons? Because the power of Jesus was not present. The power of Jesus was not present. Think about that. Wow. Did you hear that one? I'll hurry. And Jesus says to them, because it's in the valley, guys, and this is where I want you to camp out when you go home. It's in the valley that we find out that it's our dependence on God that transforms who we are. It's our dependence on God. Not on us, not on programs, not on music, not on teachers, not on leaders. It's our dependence on God that unleashes the power of God. He had told the disciples and he'd commissioned them to go out and cast out demons. So it's reasonable to assume that they would expect when this one came that they could do so. But they couldn't. Jesus says that their failure was because of unbelief. Unbelief. Do you believe that God can make a difference? Do you live like you believe God can make a difference? Do you stand firmly planted in the truth that God can make a difference? So when it didn't happen, this is interesting. The people come up, the scribes come up and they say, aha, you can't do this. Therefore, I believe that Jesus can't do this. Hey, think about this for a moment. We represent Jesus Christ, and what the world sees and believes about us, they will see and believe about Jesus Christ. Until they get to know him, we're his representative. And what they see in us is what they'll believe about him. And if they see a church where there's no power and no answers and no help and they can't find anything they need, if they believe that by entering a church, they'll believe that there is no help, no hope with him. Because we represent him. The disciples went on the defensive. And they engaged in an argument with the scribes. They were defending who? I wish they'd been defending Jesus, Wayne. They were defending themselves. Well, this is why. Their pride got in the way. Do you know what they should have done? Jesus told them, some of these only come out by prayer. Instead of entering into argument of why this wouldn't work, what should they have done? Fallen on their face before God and began praying about the situation. Church, instead of just sitting here going, well, what's that? And we had a board meeting. I got an awesome. I'm going to tell you something. You guys have an incredible leadership team that love the Lord, have the vision of what God wants to do, and pour hours of time and prayer into leading this church. And we had a great meeting the other night. We sat here and we talked and we bore open wounds and fears. And you know what we discovered? We don't have to defend. We just teach truth. These disciples began trying to defend themselves. It was their pride over their prayer. And Jesus said the reason you couldn't do it, one, is because you didn't believe, and two, because you didn't pray about it. You'll see the power of God unleashed in you. You want to see what it's like living in the valley. I'll tell you what it's like living in the valley. It is a life of prayer. It is not a thank you, Lord, for the meal. It's not where you go to the store and you buy a week's worth of groceries, pile them on the table, pray over them so you don't have to take time at supper. It's not, now I lay me down to sleep. It's not, Lord, thank you for this food, and Lord, watch over me as I travel. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about getting on your face before God and crying out to God in belief, in truth, in honesty, seeking the power of God, admitting, I don't have the answers, nor do I have the ability. And I'm tired of making excuses as to why I can't. So, Lord, I'm just going to bring it to you. Lord, here we are. Jesus said, you want to see the power of God move? You want to see this demon cast out of this boy? Pray. Some translations include and fast. Wait a minute. Whoa. You mean that's real deal? Where you like don't eat food? And you spend that time in prayer and focusing on, yeah, that's a real deal. And sometimes, if we're not willing to even give up 3 or 4 meals to spend time on our face before God, then that kind of says a whole lot about our faith and our priority and whether we believe God or not. You want to see this happen? Pray. Church, you want to see this place filled up, not for numbers' sake so we can go awesome rocking the church, but because there are lives transformed by Jesus Christ and marriages put together and children restored and health. Do you want to see that kind of growth in our church? Yes. I want to see our church full of people empowered by Jesus Christ to do the ministry of Jesus Christ. Don't you? That comes through prayer. I've been telling you for weeks and weeks, maybe months and months, to get in the Word and study. And I bet if you would be honest, the times that you really get in the Word and study, life begins to make sense and you begin to get answers. And the times that you quit, everything's just kind of bleh. Right? Because there's power in the Word of God. And if you spend time in prayer, earnest, honest, actual prayer, which is one of the hardest things we do because we've not been taught. We've been taught to say a prayer of thanks, but we've never been taught to pour our heart out before God and seek. Seek power, seek truth, seek growth. Church, the mountaintop experience is awesome because God reveals himself. And as those three disciples stood there, it's as if Jesus, if you would allow me to say this, took off the robe of his flesh and just stood before them in his complete deity. And they saw the glory and the power of God. I long for that. I want to see that. I want to understand that. I want to see the radiance of Jesus Christ. But we live here. This is where we live. You're hurting, I'm hurting, and the world is in desperate need. That's valley life. On the mountain, we worship. On the mountain, we see God. On the mountain, He takes preeminence over everything. In the valley, we work. I wish I could say all we got to do is just worship enough and everything's good. But we worship up there. We work down here. And He said, work while it is day, for the night cometh when no man will work. Do you understand how short time is? I don't know exactly when Jesus is going to come back, but I know this, we're one day closer today than we were yesterday. And if we see tomorrow, we'll be one day closer. You see, on the mountain, there's all worship and praise and lifting of hands and singing of hymns and the radiant and the presence of God. And I love that, and it's awesome, but it gets nothing done in the kingdom if we just live there. Because I can't translate this to a person in the valley that's hurting until I get down here with them. And I pray. And I seek God's word. And I invest time in people without expecting a return. How many people do you invest in that you never get a return from? Most. Most. How many people did Jesus invest in without getting a return from? Most. He invested His life for all who would. He gave a sacrifice for whosoever. He invested the greatest investment for every man, woman, and child. How many receive it and accept it? Few. Guys, I love to be on the mountain with you when God shows up. But I'd rather be in the valley with you where the people need Jesus. Everyone wants to stay there, way up high, where the feeling is warm. The presence of God is awesome and amazing. Where there's power. We want to avoid the valley because it's full of frustration and failure. But guys, I want to remind you something. Jesus took His disciples to the mountain. One time. One time. Right? He revealed His radiance and deity and the power of God to them one time. And then He took them to the valley and said, get at it. I hope today that you're encouraged to understand a few things about living in the valley. One is, you're not alone. We're all here. This is where life takes place. Maybe you're in a spiritual valley of your own right now and you just feel like God has just kind of left you hanging out here. I want to suggest that those feelings go away only through prayer, fasting, and the Word of God. Seek God. And sometimes when you don't know what to do and you've worked and everything you're trying seems to fail, keep doing what you know how to do and get on your face and beg God for direction. prayer. I want to encourage you today as my church family. I know that there are some folks that are out visiting family, but I want to encourage you to do something. Look at these spaces where people should be and ask, what have I done to fill them? I don't want 200 people in this building. It's too crowded. But if God wants 200 people in this building, we better get at it. And I don't want just pew riders. You say, well, you say if I don't want to do something, leave? No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying if you don't want to do something, let God transform you. Let the power of God pour out on you. Quit resisting. Let God have His way. Because the valley is full of men like this father with a son in desperate need of hope. You want to live on the mountain or live in the valley? I choose the valley. But I like to go to the mountain on occasion. I like to be recharged. I need the presence of God so that I can do here.